Gonna talk from the heart. Thanks. First of all, I guess let me write down my name, and if you want to be in contact with me, LinkedIn is the best way. It has got all of my emails and phone number, whatever you need. So I don't carry usually business cards, save the planet. So have access through that, and I promise I will answer your emails eventually. It might take a few days, a few weeks, a few months, but I will answer them, and try to be good and be responsive to the best of my abilities. As Ellie mentioned, quickly giving you background, the first 20 years of my life, I was an entrepreneur and started 10 companies, and three of them failed. My significant failures, was fired and lost a lot of money. Six of them had nice exits, and of the six, three of them were multi-billion dollar IPOs. And I went to venture capital, as I used to joke about it, moved to the dark side around 99 part-time and full-time around 2001. But from 1996, my wife and I decided that we want to give all of our money to our foundation and try to change the world for the better. And I'm just giving you this background so you have a feel. Both my wife and I have had two generations in our family have suffered being refugees. So we believe that one of the best ways we could change the world for the better is to help create peace in the world by education of the youth and empowerment of women using technology. And I'll tell you about this a little bit. But before we go on that, I always like to have an interactive type of presentations. One of the things that a nice lady, by the way, yoku dekimashita. she was talking about the nest. I'd like to mention something for you, because obviously it was an innovative company, and it is useful when we are thinking about venture capital, when we are thinking about starting your own companies, doing things. It's useful to have a framework, a big picture of what is happening in the world, so that if you use it as a framework, then making a lot of decisions for you becomes natural, because you don't need to go and get five PhDs about whether I make investments or not. You can use some simple tests to see whether this kind of a thing is aligned with the major wave that is coming along. And if it is, chances are when a big wave is coming, anybody who is even half-assed surfer can do something. But if there is no wave coming, doesn't matter how good of a surfer you are, you can't catch anything, so you are there and not making any progress. So to give you a feel for this, I'm going to give you a six-dimensional matrix of global innovation economy. And this might appear too brainy or too difficult. It's actually quite simple concepts, and we will use examples like Nest and see why they were so successful and what has happened there. The first dimension is information technology dimension. Can you all see it if I write in here? So we have a pyramid that I write it first, and then I will describe. So this is value. We have this pyramid composed of manual, mechanical, electromechanical, microelectronics, software, and content. And if there is one thing I would push you to think about is memorize this however you can, because it's one of the big, huge dimensions of that six-dimensional matrix. But to make it a little bit easier to follow, pick up any task, anything in our history that we do, you have choices. You can do it manual, mechanical, electromechanical, microelectronics, software, or content. The higher you go, the higher is your productivity, and you can make more money. Just as simple as that. Let's pick up a simple task. Let's say photography, image reproduction. If I sit in here and start to do painting, try to recreate this one by my hand, it would take me a couple hours, as lousy as a painter as I am. By the end of the day, somebody out of goodness of their heart might buy my painting for $5, if I'm lucky. Or maybe more like $2 or 50 cents, I don't know, or I have to give it away. If I use the mechanical camera, which many of you, since you're so young, may not remember, we used to have these cameras that were mechanical, that opened the aperture and closed it. It was a very simple mechanical thing. And you were at the mercy of, when you clicked it, how good was the, you know, conditions, the lighting, the shadows, this or that, and a little bit of flexibility with how wide you could make the aperture or close it, and how much you would zoom in or out. Very limited capabilities. Then electromechanical cameras came along, which became much nicer because you push a button and very quickly it would take 10 pictures. It would open and close, open and close, open and close. And out of those 10 pictures, one of them had a higher chance to have captured when somebody was not yawning or somebody was did not have their eyes closed or whatever. And the lighting might have been better. When microelectronics came, the digital cameras, I'm sure all of you are very familiar with that, the things changed. And all of the film industry went away. You didn't have to print this stuff. You could take 1,000 pictures, only keep 2 of them or 5 of them, throw away the rest of them. And as more and more elements of software came along, within that microelectronics camera, the digital camera, you could actually zoom into the right face, say this is the one that I want to be sharp, make all of these be different. You could have it to track specific objects, figure out who is a person, who is a scene, all sorts of stuff. And then if you look at the content, companies like Instagram showed up, companies like Flickr, companies like Facebook, that they didn't even take a picture. All they did was they took my pictures and your pictures and improved upon it and went and moved it around. And guess what? Do you want to be in the business of sitting around and painting this room? Or you want to be on the Facebook business? Or you want to be on the Instagram business? The higher you go, the more you can add value and have value. So what did Nest do? All the thermostats which were there before were analog and based on simple mechanical, or more sophisticated ones were electromechanical. You would move something around, a few mechanical things would happen, and that was it. No history of your actions, none of that. The world was stuck in these two. And Nest came and said, we are going to go and use microelectronics with a powerful processor in it that has capabilities like any cell phone, has Wi-Fi connectivity on that, has a lot of oomph that can do graphics. You can just see where the things are, can, you know, paint a little nice green leaf for you. But much more important, the software and the connectivity would allow a lot of information to be learned, to be gathered about your habits, and a lot of information from internet to come along. Whether the current Nest does it or not, one does not need to be Einstein to figure out that, hey, if it is, say, 60 degrees outside, and Kamran is turning his thermostat to 80 degrees, maybe he's not the most concerned about environment. Or maybe he is suffering from some sort of ailment that he really needs a hot home. What is the value of that information? If I'm sick, maybe I might need a few pieces of medicine. Maybe I need a trip to the doctor. Maybe some clinic could send me an ad. You see where I'm going? It's that kind of information that makes Google to be really interested, because it starts to create profiles of who the hell Kamran is and what is my behavior, or what's our house's behavior between me and my wife, and what sorts of things we do, and what time do we leave home, and when do we come back. And from where do we set up the thermostat? Think about all of this. A lot of software is there and a lot of content is there that's extremely valuable, that makes the process of you receiving an ad become magical. So how the hell did Google know that I had a cold and it's sending me some ads about, you know, I don't know, Advil or whatever cold medicine, NyQuil, whatever you want. So the fact that these guys, Tony Fadell, who has been the father of a lot of the designs, consumer-oriented products that have a huge amount of software and content embedded in them, goes and starts a new company, any venture capitalist who knew anything about Tony would have stood outside and said, please, please, please take my money. Especially because he brought a very powerful team with him from Apple. Because one of the big risks that anybody has to look at is, do these teams know how to work together? And many times, as we all know, we are human beings and we have differences of opinion and egos and whatever, and some of us can work together and some of us cannot. This was a proven team that had done the iPhone, some very complicated, very successful consumer electronic products. So now, as you look at the future, you say, what is going to happen with this pyramid? Well, first of all, every single function that we are doing in our lives is going through this. Every single example, books, we used to write them, then we printed them mechanically, electromechanically, we went to microelectronics, Amazon came along, huge businesses disappeared, new ones came along and got that. Music, finance. Remember abacus? First by hand mechanical was abacus. You might have seen parts of that. Electromechanical, electronics, the first calculator who came up, I was in college. The moment it came, before that we used to have these things called slide rules. And we used to have them. If you have never seen it, it's probably in some museums. It was something this big, and we would move it mechanically around and do calculations. All of that disappeared, and it went through today. What are the most successful financial companies? Financial companies. It's the ones who understand the content. develop some very advanced derivative algorithms and go and hedge on this thing and bet against that and try to do high frequency trading and all of that and create billions of dollars. In everything you could think about, another big, big thing that recently we have seen in the last couple of years, Tesla. What did Tesla do? All the cars were stuck in electromechanical. Mercedes, Toyota, General Motors, all of them were stuck in that. Tesla came and said, electric car, using microelectronics, using software, using the content. How many of you have test driven a Tesla? How many of you have seen a Tesla? How many of you have sat at least inside it or looked inside it? You know, it has nothing in it. So simple. No carburetor, no radiator, no transmission, no buttons. All of those.
Trunk is also a joke.
Trunk is what?
A joke. Like you can't even sit up. Like you have to.
The trunk? Are you saying you sit in the trunk?
Yeah, you can sit in the trunk.
Ah, right? I didn't know that. I don't have the habit of sitting in the trunk, but sorry if you were suffering sitting in the trunk. And I will tell them to make the trunk to be a little bit higher so you wouldn't suffer. But I usually don't have the habit, but I respect your, you know, wishes. It is an amazing. Do you know the new model that they are doing in January?
X.
Four-wheel drive, fuel efficiency of about 100 miles per gallon, 0 to 60 is around 3.2 seconds. Ferrari would wish to get there. Lamborghini would wish to get there. It has left all of them in the dust, and it does that carrying four passengers. It's not like Ferrari that just eliminates everything and puts one person behind the wheel to try to do that. That's real innovation. Changes the whole rules of the game. And if you buy the new one, I live on a hill. When I'm trying to go to my driveway, I have to watch it, make sure that, you know, I don't hit the bumper in front. Tesla has ability like, you know, rising the shock absorbers, the height increases. So that was available before in Range Rovers. But what they did is because it has a processor inside it and a lot of software and content, one time I do that, it remembers. Next time I'm coming to my home, it has GPS, it automatically raises that. So I never ever am hitting the side of the road because of the hill. So what is going to happen in the world? First of all, as a big picture, everything we do is going through this, and the people who figure out when is the right time to go from mechanical to electromechanical, or from electromechanical to microelectronics, or here to that or that, are the big winners. Second thing is, as time passes by, this pyramid becomes like this first, everything becomes like that, then it becomes like this. Very few things we would do by hand, or we would do with mechanical things, electromechanical, whatever. I forgot to tell you, Tesla has no maintenance, no tune-up. You don't go and change the oil, no oil. Think about it, a car with no maintenance. It's a very, very different approach.
Kamran, I was wondering, according to your model, if Tesla's at the microelectronic level.
Microelectronic software content, it's really in this area.
Because I was wondering, would Uber be the content play?
Uber absolutely is a content play, but for a different segment of the market, which is part of the sharing economy, and I will talk about that also.
Thank you.
But absolutely, it is a content, absolutely. Now, I was talking about Tesla being in all three of them because the fact that it knows how to use GPS, how to use Google Maps to remember where my position is to raise itself is using the content.
That's true.
It's having all of these things. So, that's the first dimension. What is the second dimension? Second dimension is nanotech. Another huge, amazing, I guess, pyramid that starts with visible to the eye, which is more than 100 microns, to microelectronics, to micro, sorry, not just to micron, or microtech, not just electronics, to nanotech, to picotech, and Fermi. So that's more than 100, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 9, 10 to the minus 12, and 10 to the minus 15. Why is that important? Because, again, everything that we touch and feel and do something is going through this. When we were, from the date that human beings were created a million years ago, till 1960s, we were in this range that we only could do stuff that we could see. When in the late 50s, early 60s, we learned how to go and do microelectronics, started to do micro movement and management of chemical elements, things started to go different. And one of them was invention of integrated circuits, because we learned how to study the material on that. Right now, where we stand on this is around this area. It's 10 to the minus 7 to 10 to the minus 10. Somewhere towards the upper end of, the lower end of nanotech and the upper end of picotech. The closer we get to picotech, the more exciting the things become. We start to go towards not just atom manipulation, but subatomic particles. And we can change completely, do magic, do the complete turning the world upside down. We already have seen from nanotech at things which were done at the level of 100 nanometers or 50 nanometers, textiles that, how many of you have seen the shirts that don't need any ironing, the jeans that never stain? You buy jeans, you can pour ketchup on it, oil on it, whatever you want, does not stain, does not need any ironing, nothing. You just buy one. You can wear it days after days after days. I think when I was in college, that was extremely attractive to me if it was available. The third dimension, which is parallel of this, except it is for organic material. Exactly parallel, goes through the same things, but this is molecular biology. It's actually dealing with organic material at the molecular level. Whether it's plants, whether it's human beings, whether it's animals. Going at the level of 10 to the minus 7, 10 to the minus 10, bringing amazing changes, things that you have never, ever dreamt of. Every one of you who is below the age of 30, if you keep track of the advances on this, will live at least 100, maybe 150 years, with probably the body of a 30-something-year-old person. Sounds like becoming a vampire, huh? But I'm not talking about nonsense. It's really happening in so many different levels. And if you want to study some of these things, how these three of them really go hand in hand, read any of Ray Kurzweil's books. You know, Singularity is a great book to read. His newest one about the human brain is an amazing book. It really opens up your mind at how many different ways things are changing because of high tech moving hand in hand. Whatever we learn in here helps here. Whatever we learn here helps that. Whatever we learn here helps here, or vice versa. These three are all going up towards a whole new world that eventually we would never die. That all of our medicine becomes individually prescribed to what Cameron's body needs, not what his body needs or what her body needs. No more generic things, one size fits all. No more big corporations that are doing everything in manufacturing one thing that should be good for everyone. Using 3D printing, using some of the principles of nanotech, amazing stuff you could do, combined with IT. Already we have, using nanotech, we have developed things like carbon nanotubes, carbon fiber. Boeing has started to use it. My car has some part of that. I paid $10,000 extra to get some of this carbon fiber stuff. It's stronger than steel. It's on the side, so anything that rams into my car, I would not get hurt. But it's lighter than aluminum, much lighter. Boeing loves it because they can make airplanes that can carry a lot more passengers and burn a lot less fuel. Now, on each one of these, figuring out when is it that you go from one layer to another is a very key issue. So that's where the fourth dimension comes up. So that's one, two, three. Fourth dimension is timing. If you figure out when is the right time to do this, if you are too late, there are too many people who are already doing it. If you are too early, you get your ass kicked and you lose a lot of money and you get fired. Remember I said three of my companies failed big time? First big failure I had was my third company. It was called Momenta. Go and check on Momenta computer, you will see 1991. I designed a tablet. No buttons, not one like iPad, or no buttons. User interface was so advanced. No buttons that had the, I guess, wish to be the iPad. 1991, I was on the cover of 20 magazines. A little bit too early. We got orders for $300 million first year. As I said, I was on the cover of magazines in 1992, 20 of them. I got 10 awards as the MVP, most valuable contribution, future, whatever, whatever. I cut down my predictions, forecast for everything, said 100 million would be our first year. Told that to my board, and we started to ship the product. Product was way ahead of its time. No internet, no wireless connectivity, no color LCDs. So we had to invent everything to make something work half-assed. Why? Because I had a dream in 1989. After I had taken my second company, Cirrus Logic Public, it's going through the roof. Everything is phenomenal. I had this crazy dream that I'm reading Wall Street Journal, and a special piece of paper, front page, had an article about automotive industry. And in my dream, there was an ad on the front page from Honda, the Japanese car company. And in my dream, my finger went and touched it, and it became alive and gave me a color video. Next day, I went and I put my team and I said, you guys, I'm gonna leave Cirrus in a few months. I have to go and pursue my new dream. Put some amazing team together to go and make it happen. But it was way too early. My seventh company that failed. I mean, my second one, but it was the seventh company I started. We were Skype in 1999, 4 years before the deregulations happened and the monopoly of telcos allowed two guys from Estonia to go and challenge AT&T and Deutsche Telekom. So being too early is not good.
I'd like to just share a fact about Kamran and Momenta that he didn't mention. While Kamran has been one of the most successful entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley in terms of making just boatloads of money for investors, in that case, Kamran managed to accomplish having the biggest single rapid loss in venture capital in the history of the industry.
Till then, $40 million in 2.5 years.
How come you didn't know it was too early at the time? Did it seem like it was on time to you?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, knowing when the timing is right is.
How do you know?
I can tell you right now, after having learned 20-some years, the best I can tell you is forget about all of the things your lawyers tell you about keep the ideas careful, quiet, go and work in a lab secretly, get patents, do all of that. That's all a whole bunch of horseshit. The moment you have an idea that you believe is a good idea, go out there and test it and figure out with real customers, real people, to see how useful the things are and figure out what is the bare minimum required to get a product out of your idea. And that whole concept of the bare minimum is the key. We screw that up royally. My vice president of marketing, who had been director of marketing for Macintosh from Apple, you know, I hired some of the biggest names you could. I hired the chief operating officer of Apple to be my COO. I hired the CFO of Seagate to be my CFO. I hired president of number one laptop maker to be my VP of sales. All these big guys I hired, my vice president of marketing did not help us to really create the minimum set of products and functions that would be saleable. So we created a product that did many things, but majority of them half-assed. We developed chips, we developed system, we developed a lot of communication stuff, operating system, 10 application software. We were so many companies in one. And we tried to do everything for everyone day one. Apple learned that lesson very early. Look at iPhone 6 versus iPhone 1. Imagine if Apple was driven by engineering team who knew the basic specs of iPhone 6. And we say, let's delay it till we get all of these features in it. It would have been a major disaster. But figuring out what's the bare minimum that you go and can make a product is key. And then you do rapid prototype. You keep coming up with additional things, come up 6 months later with another version, a year later another version, 6 months later another one. You keep improving and adding that. There is this chasm. They call it the valley of death. To go from a concept to real saleable product. And God knows if you study 99% of startups that fail, they don't cross that valley of death. It's the biggest problem. So just understand, ideas come a dime a dozen. Don't worry about protecting your idea, listening to the goddamn lawyers telling you, don't talk to anyone, hold it here, get patents, this or that. The moment you can go and get feedback, absolutely run out and do it, because execution is all that counts. Just to tell you, it wasn't just Momenta that failed. My engineers, many of them went to Apple, and Apple created a better version of Momenta called Newton. And they lost a few hundred million. First company that figured out how to go and do that, eliminated the finger, went with a pen, a small screen called palm computing, and did very, very, very little things. Very little things. Didn't do 10 applications, didn't try to be everything. Just figured out what is the bare minimum that could be creating a product that sells. So, number four is timing. What's number five? Any suggestions?
Luck?
We don't talk about luck in there. No. I'm talking about global innovation economy. You are right. I mean, many times, it's better to be lucky than smart. I've been accused of being a lot more luckier than smart. That has been a common theme. Any other suggestions? Does everything happen at the same time all over the world? Location, geography. 3G happened first in Europe. US was really behind, really got screwed up. 4G happened first where? Korea, South Korea. Who said that? Oh, are you from South Korea? I'm impressed you know that, because one of my companies developed 4G, and our first customer who understood what the hell we were talking about was Korea Telecom, and we were so amazed. Verizon doesn't know what the hell we are saying, and he doesn't know, and Korea Telecom said, yes, come on over. How quickly can you make these chips? I said, wow, what an enlightened group of people. Yeah, a year and a half before U.S., it happened in South Korea, then U.S., and this time Europe is way behind. Now, who wants to bet where is 5G going to come out and where is it going to take off? Anything? How many of you know what are the big contenders for 5G? Come on, you guys, I thought you are studying these things, reading about these things. What's going on? Have you heard of the Google Balloon Project?
Sure.
Google is trying to do 5G by eliminating a lot of telcos. Why do we need them? They have been monopolies controlled by a lot of old men who have had this unholy, you know, hold on the poor consumers, and
Elon Musk's satellite project.
That's another one.
Facebook.
What Google is doing is they are designing these very advanced balloons. It's fascinating. That can go up the stratosphere. 40, 50,000, 60,000, 50,000 something feet. Amazing. And because Google has so much knowledge of the planet and the things, the wind currents, the situation, they can make these, not send one of them, not two, not five, thousands of them, have them circle different latitudes in the air, and they go and do their turn in a proper way, proper spacing, and then they come down, get refurbished, and go back again and do this. Pretty amazing stuff, huh? They know which way the wind is going at 48,000 feet, at 49,000 feet, at 52,000 feet. They move it up or down. If they need to continue this direction, there is always some wind up there that can go the right way. They will figure it out and align these things. So Google is good with big data. Facebook says, oh, there is this thing called drones. Why do we need balloons that all you can do is just go up and down? We need something that can go up and down and sideways and left and right and whatever called drone. Maybe we should make something. Now, they haven't told me. I'm just guessing that's what they are doing, so you haven't heard it from me. Maybe solar drones would make sense because you go above the elements, above the clouds at that high level, plenty of sun. No storms, none of these things, and the drone can keep getting a lot of energy and moving up there. Now, what's the advantage of sending something up there? Not where the satellites are, which is out of our atmosphere, but below that. Sorry? No. I'm talking about the, for Google, you're right, but I'm talking about the advantages when you go up. Your coverage increases. In here, the reason Wi-Fi has certain limitations, besides what IEEE agreed upon, is because there are obstacles. The walls, the towers, whatever, limit the range of a wireless connection. As you go up, there is very little. So one balloon or one drone can cover a huge area. Because these guys are so tiny and they're up there, no country really has ability to shoot them down. So bye-bye China censorship. Maybe even bye-bye NSA. Spying on all of us.
Actually, hemp would be fine.
Sorry?
Hemp would be a good way to kill them.
Yeah, you could. I'm sure creative dictators always try to find different ways to try to destroy these. But there is always better technology solutions that come up. There is a race between those of us who are trying to improve our lives and improve the lives of people, and those of us who are scared by that and want to control us and want to tell us what to do and not use our brains. We'll talk about that dimension in a minute. So what is the fifth is geography. And why is it so important? It's the same way as timing for each sector. Know when is the right time for automotive industry to go and have this thing to do the right kind of investments and the right kind of entrepreneurial work to change the rules. It's also important to know if something worked in the US, when is the right time to introduce it in Germany? When is the right time to introduce it in Malaysia? When is the right time to introduce it in Zimbabwe? Whole new opportunities come out. You watch and see what business model works, how it's done, how is their user interface, you go and create the Kenyan version of that service. And guess what? 2 years later, 3 years later, 4 years later, a multi-billion dollar company like eBay, like Facebook, like Google wants to go to Kenyan market. They can start from scratch, or they can come and pay 50 million, 100 million, 200 million to buy what you have done. Very simple strategy. Two brothers from Germany have figured this out. They were the founders of Rocket Internet. Go and check them out. They are like clockwork. They have created a company worth tens of billions of dollars, going and exactly based on timing and geography and figuring out when this move to software and content is going to happen. And they go and set up a company with lots of money there, beat out the whole competition, and go and create a significant company right there. Guess what? They just went and set up a $300 million company in Iran. 70-some million people, huge market. Why shouldn't Amazon, killer for Iran, be made by these German brothers? Now, there are already companies in Iran that are doing what Amazon does, but these guys say, hey, we have 300 million, we hire 1,000 people, we go and do these things quickly, we will eat their lunch, and then when Amazon finally comes 2-3 years later to do Iran, we sell it to them for $1 billion. Very, very interesting approach and quite predictable. Their company is going to file for IPO sometime Q1 of next year in Europe. It's going to be one of the biggest IPOs Europe has ever had. What's the sixth element? I'm just curious to see. Anybody can guess that. It's the toughest one. And I did not have that in my own understanding till just a while back. We are moving in the right direction. It's the moral dimension. Doing something that is right, that benefits society. If you have a choice in your lives, do something that benefits society. Instead of going and working for a tobacco company, do you really want it on your tombstone? Kamran helped kill 5 million people with lung cancer. Is that really a great achievement because I created a $10 billion tobacco company? Is that something we want? Do we want to be involved in oil, in coal, even in gas, as much as gas is better and destroys less? The new practices, the new technology in gas, this fracking destroys the planet. If you have a choice, you want to go and create a gambling company. Imagine what would be written on your tombstone. Kamran created a multi-billion dollar gambling company that helped transfer the money, which was supposed to be the food on the table, for so many children, or the tuition for school for so many kids, instead got diverted by mom or dad, most potentially dad, to Cameron's business, literally took it away from. The kids go hungry, they don't get education, and misery of the world gets added to it. So the moral dimension is very key. Do you really want to be involved in a quote-unquote defense industry, developing tools that goes and allows Big Brother to spy on all of us? Do you want to be involved in a defense industry that quote-unquote develops bombs that could kill with one drop a million people instantaneously? Do you want to be happy in your conscience that you develop the next virus that was weapon of mass destruction that some government, I won't mention who, went and used and killed 500,000 or 1 million people? If you have a choice, follow your heart and do what's right. That sixth dimension, I'm not talking about the religious dimension, I'm not talking about a dogma, I'm talking just use your own heart and say, is this helping humanity? Am I on the right side of history? If you have a choice, if you don't have a choice, you have to survive, do whatever. I'm not preaching that you should be idealistic. If you have a choice, you're starting a business, keep this moral dimension. And do something that benefits society. So with these six dimensions, the basics of global innovation economy, it comes several other characteristics of this innovation economy that is very different than anything we have had before. We all know that the system of capitalism won. The alternative methods of economy have failed, whether it's socialism, whether it's communism. I never forget one of my board members in my first, second, and third company. He was an amazing guy. In 1991, he told me, Kamran, soon we will have more communists in Berkeley than China and Russia combined. And how right he was. Have you been to Russia? Have you been to China? They might still have a communist party, but God, are they capitalists? Unfortunately, their definition of capitalism matches the definition of Wall Street. Highway robbery. Find a way to corner the consumers, extract the most amount you can out of them, screw them every which way Sunday from Sunday, and make money. What do they teach us in typical business schools? How many of you have heard a CEO, president of a company, stand up and say, my mission statement is maximize shareholder profits? How many times have you heard that? Thousands of times. That's what they teach you. Our job is maximize shareholder profits. How about employees? How many times we hear many of the firms, especially as I say, Wall Street as capitalism 1.0. Capitalism 1.0 was about speculation capitalism. What's the mantra of speculation capitalism? Buy low, sell high. That's the whole thing you do. You don't create any jobs. You might destroy the whole economy of a country. You might hedge against IBM and go and say the price of shares is gonna go down and down and down, and even spread rumors. And when the stock goes down, you make a ton of money. And doesn't matter that IBM has to lay off thousands of people. You made money by creating misery for other people. What is capitalism 2.0? It's innovation capitalism. You have four constituents. Take care of your customers,
take care of your employees, take care of the environment, be a good corporate citizen, show corporate social responsibility. And I promise you, you do those right, you will be having very, very high returns for your shareholders. You don't believe me? Look at Intel. Look at Google. Look at Facebook. Look at Twitter. Look at eBay. Would you like to be a shareholder of Goldman Sachs or a shareholder of Google? How many of you know what's the value of Tesla right now? Tesla versus the biggest car company out there being VW or GM. Any ideas?
It's small.
No, large. Is it 200 billion?
Tesla today is worth more than any automobile company in the world. Higher than GM, higher than VW, higher than Mercedes. How low?
GM stock price is at 30 and Tesla's at 242.
But that's not the only thing. You should multiply by how many shares are outstanding, and you will see on Yahoo Finance, I didn't check it, you know, the last few days, but it was like that last time I checked it about a month ago.
But isn't the number of cars only like 30,000?
It's only 30,000, but Tesla is not an electromechanical old company. It's these three levels, and anybody who has a half a brain figures out this is the way of the future. They can't make enough of this. They're running as fast as they can. They bought Toyota's manufacturing facility. They're ramping up like crazy. They have put their advanced battery technology for licensing so that many, many other people would follow that. It's gonna become like Microsoft was licensing the software to a lot of people. These guys would do. They will have amazing impact in changing the world and saving the planet. And at the same time, being highly, highly profitable company. So what are the characteristics of innovation economy? In capitalism 1.0, the style of management is dictatorship, like many of the governments. One, maximum two people on the top, typically old men, two brothers, Koch brothers. They go own everything, 100%, 99%. If they're public, they have sold some of the shares on the public market, but they still own majority of the shares of the company. That's capitalism 1.0. They are the owners. They are dictators. They don't need anybody. They hire and fire everybody. They do whatever they please. So, style of ownership is sole ownership, and style of management is dictatorship. How is it in innovation economy? We have a basic concept of shared ownership. Every high-tech company goes and gives a lot of shares to all employees. It says we are in this thing together. When Apple went public, not just Steve Jobs that made a lot of money, he made a ton of money, but over 100 people became millionaires. When Facebook went public, over 1,000 employees became millionaires. How is that for shared ownership? And when you have shared ownership, people have a piece of the action. They care. They want to know. So the style of management is not micromanagement, it's not dictatorship. is participative management, and it's actually leadership. How many of you understand the concept between leadership and management? We manage cows, right? Say, hey, all the cows should go this direction with guardrails, no thinking, boom, go. Do we want to be treated like cows? Do we like to be micromanaged? Do we like to be told what to do? If we have a choice? Let me give you an example. That this is not theoretical, it's not utopian. It's something that every good Silicon Valley, every good innovative company has learned, or they would not succeed beyond a certain level. If I'm a micromanager and I have to get this team to go to, say, catch a flight tonight at 11 p.m. out of SFO, San Francisco Airport. A micromanager, a general in the army, says, here's a policy manual, here is a 10-page description, you go out, you turn left on this street, you take that, you take one, you go this way, you move that way, you make three stops, there is a light, turn left on the right, turn right on that, do this, that, everything is spelled out for you. You don't have to use your brain. What does a leader do? A leader gives some high-level ideas. Hey, team, I'm like a coach. I'm not going to do everything for you. We need to be by 11 p.m. in SFO. You come up and tell me how you're planning to go there. Any ideas right now? She might raise her hand and say, I have a car and I have checked. There is parking available, long-term parking. If I get there about 2 hours, 2.5 hours before flight time, I have enough time to go and park my car and get it. And he might say, oh, I know this thing called Uber. I'm gonna use Uber and, you know, it's gonna take me. And she might say, I have this friend of mine and, you know, he really cares for me and I'm going to talk him into giving me a ride. Why should all of you do what I think should be done? Any one of these methods are good. So, as a leader, what would I do? Say, hey, it seems like at least three methods have come. Anybody else has some ideas? You can talk your friend into it, you can take an Uber, you can take a taxi, you can drive your own car. Leave it up to you to figure out what makes sense for you. But I don't abdicate that. I don't say, okay, see you at 11 o'clock. That is abdication. I ask each one of you to report back to me where you are and what you have decided in a couple hours. And then a couple hours after that. And when I see that you say, I'm stuck, the Uber did not come up, and this or that, I say, well, have you thought about maybe calling a neighbor to give you a ride? I don't say go and call your neighbors. Have you thought about it? Let the person go and figure out what they should do on their own. So this way they grow. And allow them to make small mistakes. Even though if I know all the answers, that hey, the best way to go from here to there is for all of us come together and we charter a bus and it's the cheapest one to go. But if nobody came up with that solution, what is my choice? I could throw that in there and say, shall we look into chartering a bus? See if anybody jumps on that. This way they learn. And everybody says, oh, we hadn't thought of it. But they feel it is their idea. And she might say, yeah, I know this good bus company that's quite cheap. And she says, no, I got another one that's better. Let me call them up for that. But they have ownership because they feel they came up with that and got that going. Or they may decide, no, we are not going to do that. And guess what? If I can afford to have everybody do their own thing and come up with a thing, maybe I should let them do that. Because what's the worst case that they pay? It costs a little bit more, yeah. But if they're willing to pay that themselves, or they're using their friends and imposing on their friends to do that, it's not the best solution, but they have had freedom to achieve something. And if there are delays and mistakes, they learn something from it. And guess what? Every now and then, I, being Mr. Know-it-all, because I've done all of that, find out that, holy shit, she came up with an idea I'd never ever thought of. And that's 10 times better than I thought. And I learned something. Because I'm not the holder of all the knowledge of the universe. That's what a leader knows. A good leader knows, he or she actually knows very little. And has got to get the team to start to contribute, to move the things forward. So leadership versus management. Participation versus dictatorship. Now, it's not a democracy. It's not that she says we have to do this, she says no, we have to do that, he says we have to do that, and she says we have to do something, even we have chaos like our goddamn Congress or whatever, and nothing moves forward. If things are not moving forward, the leader says, yeah, we're running out of time. I make an executive decision that for this, we are going to move this way. But you do that rarely. If you have let your team develop and start to use their brains rather than be slaves and robots. That's the thing very rarely you have to do. Now, what are the other characteristics? So we talked about dictatorship versus leadership, participative management, single ownership versus shared ownership, we also talked about capitalism 1.0 is about the speculation, is about doing whatever to make money. Speculation, this one is make a product or service to benefit society. Talked about take care of your customers, employees, and environment, and society. All of these are characteristics of that. What else? Any ideas, differences? Capitalism 1.0, couple people own everything. They hire and give promotions to whoever they like. Their cousin, their uncle, their friend, regardless of whether they have real ability or not. It's nepotism, typically. Capitalism 2.0 is meritocracy. Everything is done based on merit. Doesn't matter where you are coming from. in capitalism 1.0, if you're the son of the king, if you are related to the royal family, if you're part of the blue blood, you get whatever you want. Look at the majority of developing countries. Even in US, we have the Bush dynasty, we have the Clinton dynasty, that the things happen. But at least in here, if the person doesn't merit that, we complain. When George Bush, 43, got elected, we all complained after a while and said, God, maybe we should not have just followed the nepotism. We don't care where you come from, what's your religion, what's your gender, what is your sexual orientation. All we care about is your merit. And interestingly enough, within this pyramid, it's the first time in the history that young people can study the rules carefully so they can break them properly, as Dalai Lama says. A very key thing, study the rules carefully so you can break them properly. All the previous industries, all the previous economies, we needed either the natural resources, which were in the hands of old men, because they were the kings, they were the sheikhs, they were the ayatollahs, they were whatever, and they held all the rights to that. How many female ayatollahs do you know? How many female priests do you know? Female pope? Female rabbi?
Yes. Female rabbis are quite common.
How many? Percentage. Are we talking about 10 versus 90?
No, you're right.
Thank you. I know a few female priests, but again, we are talking about, you know, where the power structure is. Hands of old men. However, for the first time in the history, these three, all they require is this, the brain, and the access to high-speed broadband. That's it. Two guys from Estonia created Skype. Do you all remember AT&T, Verizon, Deutsche Telekom, British Telecom? Make a call, $3, $5 per minute. Old men monopolizing everything. Two young men came up and pissed all over that. Totally destroyed the whole infrastructure and turned the things upside down. Music industry. Poor artists would work so hard, make a CD, the artist would get a buck, consumer pays $20. Where did that $19 go? Old men controlled the channels of distribution because of past relationships. We talked about Uber. How many of you have taken taxis in New York? And how fun was your experience? So many times. Few taxis around. Heavens forbid if it is raining. My God, not enough taxis around. You get into a goddamn taxi, it's 20-year-old taxi, it pollutes the air, it's noisy. The legroom is so little. There is this wall between you and the driver. Driver is cussing and, you know, cursing everyone and everything because poor guy works 14 hours a day, gets very little money. You pay a ton of money, you get very little legroom, a dirty cab, horrible service. Where does that money go? Into the hands of a lot of old men who have controlled and set up all of the rules. Uber comes, pisses all over this, and goes and allows people to get nice cars. You pay less as a consumer, the driver gets more money. And the driver is not working 16 hours a day to make a living. Many times, Uber drivers I have are ladies. Mom just took kids to the school, has 3 hours to make some money, because they get rating from me and everybody who uses that, they make sure the car is clean because they want to get 4-star rating. They get 2-star or 1-star, nobody would select them. And in every major city, I have a choice. Do I want a small car, a bigger car, a luxury car, different prices at my choice? And within a few minutes, it comes. Uber eliminated the power of old men. And that's why if you look at these new things, how many of you know chairman of Intel is a lady? CEO of HP is a lady. President of Facebook is a lady. President of Yahoo is a lady. And these are not 80-year-old ladies. 30, 40, young people are taking away. And why is that? Because it's for the first time. You don't need natural resources. You don't need all those under the table agreements. And you don't need the big muscles. To be in the industry, you don't need to use the, you know, shovel and the pick and whatever, dig harder or do this or that. All it requires is the brain. And in brain, men and women are equal. And sexual orientation doesn't matter. And whether you come from Israel or Palestine doesn't matter. Whether you are a Muslim or Christian, who gives a damn? All people care about is who has the best brain and who comes up with a new idea that benefits, makes their life easier. In many of my companies, I have had Arabs and Jews work with me. No issues. I have had Pakistanis and Indians work for with me. No issues. Nobody cares what's their religion, what's their thing. All they care about is who is contributing more. This issue of meritocracy is not being caught in the past, where you come from, what is my country, is the line in here, is the border this way or that. That's all nonsense. Anybody who talks about those things, they're living in the past. Future is different. How is it that future is different? I like to quote, borrow a quote from Martin Luther King. He says, the arc of the history of the morality in the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. He said this when many people were losing faith. Many people were fighting them, did not want to give them equal rights. And many were advocating we should use violence to fight back. He said, no, be patient. Good things are going to happen. This arc, the history of morality in the universe, is long, but it's going to be in the right place, bent towards justice. So, borrowing that great idea, I would say the arc of the history of human evolution, the evolution of our brains, evolution of our soul, is long. But it bends towards unification. Why do I say that? Am I a prophet? Hell no. What the hell do I know? Why do I say that? It's very simple. How old are human beings? Any ideas?
200,000 years, maybe?
I'm talking about when we started to stand up and started to go. We have found
bones 1.2 million years. I guess a few weeks ago there were some bones that were 4 million years. But somewhere up there, whether it's 200,000 or a million or 2 million or whatever.
7 million since we separated from the chimps.
Depends on where you come along and get that. Or you could say 65 million years since dinosaurs moved away and mammals started.
Yeah.
But let's say millions.
Yeah.
At least a million. What were the characteristics of us when we were just standing up and going for a few million years? We had peace in our cave. Within our family of 20, 30, mom, dad, uncle, aunt, grandpa, kids, we had peace, but we would fight with another kid, another kid, and another kid. It took us a few million years to go from 20, 30 people having cooperation and peace till 10,000 years ago. So if you say, this is unification, and this is time. It took a long time, let's say more than a million years, to go from 20 people, let's say a village of 200 people, or 300 people, 400 people. What caused that to happen? We evolved, we developed technology of farming. We learned from social innovation about distribution of labor. We said, you do the farming, you be the butcher, you be the security guard, and you be the farmer, that is our banker. That, no, they didn't have money. You be the other one, we distributed. And we use barter money. So such a long time it took to go from 20 to 200. Then things started to go faster. We invented the wheel, and we could carry our goods from this village to this village, sell our wheat, get a coin, because we invented the coin as a money, and take the coin to another village and get some meat and come back. So villages started to unite, cooperate. We created the town, and then created the city, went to 10,000, 20,000, half a million, a million. And it was roughly a couple hundred years ago that the first Uber country was created, United States of America. Effectively 50 countries come together, even though they had different views. Some were Irish, some were French, some were Spanish, some were whatever, whatever. Came together, created a system that they started to cooperate with each other. And the technology that allowed that to happen was the telegraph, was a railroad system. Country that built railroads everywhere. And later on, the highway system. And later on, we were the first country that developed the network of airplanes. You could fly from anywhere in the US to anywhere using airplanes very fast. So it allowed the transfer of knowledge, the communication, everything happened a lot faster. So this started to become a million years here, say, 10,000 years ago, so then 9,800 years to get to 200, 300 million. And then the next Uber country, did it take another 9,800 years?
No.
Hell no. EU was created in less than 200 years. So you got US, and then you got EU. So US is expanding through NAFTA to Canada, to Mexico. EU started with 15 countries and now there is 29. I was talking to Prime Minister of Macedonia and he was saying, we want to join EU. We all have read in the news about
how Ukraine wants to join EU and Turkey wants to join EU. More and more countries want to join. Not because EU is attacking and trying to grab this like Genghis Khan did. Putin doesn't understand why is it that Ukrainians are interested to join EU. His understanding is old. Attack, capture. So, anybody who looks at this kind of a thing says, hey, when would we have 7 billion people? Or 8 billion, 9 billion, as population is increasing. Be all united. And what technology is going to make that happen? Internet, high speed, connectivity, broadband. That's why my wife and I gave our money to our foundation. Between 1996 and 2003, we set up computer labs in 6,400 schools in 36 countries to fire off, get the internet revolution started in 36 different countries. We trained tens of thousands of teachers how to use computers, how to use the new tools. Why? Because we zeroed in. If young people go and have access to this tool, communicate with each other, they would refuse to follow, at some point, a corrupt leader, whether it is political or religious leader, who says, we are the only good people, attack and kill, these people are evil. Actually, I would argue, we have a bigger Uber country, bigger than US and EU combined. Anybody knows? The United Citizens of Facebook.
Yeah.
1.1 billion.
I was
going
to say Google.
It's happening. When people through the Facebook start to learn about each other's religions, about each other's ideas, about the beauty each one of us have, their propensity to go and believe a whole bunch of bullshit that in the name of patriotism we should go and attack another country and kill tens of thousands of people or hundreds of thousands. Say, hey, our friends in that country, they are not evil, they are like us. I don't want to attack them. Or a religious leader says, we are the only ones who are going to go to heaven. You say, you believe in a God that was so unfair that only created 7 billion people, but only selected 100 million or a billion of them to go to heaven, and everybody else is going to go to hell and burn till eternity? Is that a nice God? Is that the kind of God we should follow? Or maybe it's this leader that we shouldn't follow?
Won't this disrupt cultures and religion rather extensively?
Mm-hmm. I'll tell you. Story from a dear friend of mine, Anusha Ansari, very successful Iranian-American lady, young lady. She and her husband and a couple other co-founders created the company, sold it for a few hundred million. She decided to take 20 million of that to be the first female tourist astronaut. First in the history. Paid 20 million to Russian government to go and get 6 months training in Kazakhstan and go to the space station a few years back, 5-6 years ago. She being Iranian American wanted the flag of Iran on the left, that's where she was born, and flag of United States on her suit on the right side.
Yeah.
US government said no, and Iranian government said hell no. Or vice versa. I don't know. And she said, with all due respect, I was going to say something nasty, but she never says anything nasty. She's a very nice lady. She said, I'm paying 20 million. I decide what I want to wear on my astronaut suit.
with all due respect, thank you very much for your input, but I'm gonna do what I want to do. So she wore it, went up to the space station every 41 minutes up there. It goes around the whole planet. So she's so anxious. This has been a childhood dream to see it, and she's looking for the country she was born in and the country that she loves has been living for so many years. And guess how disappointed she was when she couldn't find either one of them. Guess what? There are no goddamn lines drawn up there since this is Iran and this is Iraq and this is Turkey and this is India and this is Pakistan. There are no lines drawn between Mexico, United States, Canada, Alaska, Soviet Union. There are no lines. Just one continuous land. And when you go up there, you see how huge the universe is. See how stupid it is to sit around and argue about these nonsense borders. And the thing that my race is better than your race or my religion is better than yours. When you have billions of galaxies. Billions of galaxies. Each galaxy has got billions of stars. And each star has got its own star system. And we are one part. One star system, or one of these. And we think we are the center of the universe, and there was this God that created all of this, but selected us to go to heaven, and the rest are all going to burn in hell. You know, many religions say God created us in His own image. His own image. You know what Voltaire says? If God created us in His own image, we did a hell of a job reciprocating it. What is the image of the God? Old man. Who wrote those books? Old men. Who did they give the power to? Old men. Not young people, not women. Talk about a more unnatural way. Respect for the elder? Does old lion get anything? The young lion, that's smart, that's agile, that goes and does all the value added. Ah, okay, thanks for telling me. I should end soon. 2 minutes, 5 minutes?
5 minutes is great.
Okay. So, if we look at the natural order of the things, is the young people, equally men and women, who are in charge. And many of the natural pagan religions actually put women at a higher level. Here is the chance we can get the things go back to natural. Why should we follow an Ayatollah who is 80 some years old and is senile and brain doesn't work, the things are not working out? Why should we follow a Pope? Why should we follow, I'm not picking up on anybody, any leader. Ronald Reagan, the last couple of years of his presidency, was suffering from Alzheimer's, didn't remember anything. And this guy is supposed to make all the decisions. Why shouldn't we change the order of the things and go back to meritocracy? The world is not the bakery, that whoever got there first gets to get the bread first. I was 27 years old when I started my first company. All of my VPs were all older than me. I didn't get to be the leader because I was the oldest. I knew a little bit about how the things work and did a few things right to lead the team. We sold it before I was 30 years old for $75 million. has meritocracy. And the last part I will say, since I have to finish, it's perfect timing. The last element of global innovation, economy, culture is transparency. Again, Capitalism 1.0, keeping everything opaque. I have two books, three books, typical businesses. This is the book I run business on. This is what I show my wife, so she wouldn't ask for too much money. And this is what I show to IRS, so that I pay less taxes. Two, three different books. Transparency, open up. What do you have to hide? So I hope I have given you this basic global framework of where to go and what to look at. And any decision you want to make, simply look at it against these six dimensions and that arc of history towards unification. If it is something that's benefiting humanity, something that's bringing people closer together, something that's based on meritocracy, yeah, do it. Jump on it. But if it is something that hurts humanity, is the wrong thing? Absolutely not. Stay away from it. And that also follow your heart. Because Paulo Coelho, if you're familiar, the great writer behind The Alchemist, he says, all of us are born with a childhood dream. And if we follow that and stick to it, we will be very happy. If we don't, we are condemned to come back again, be reincarnated, follow it up. So it's not how much money we make. It's not how many homes we have. It is following your heart and going to do what it said. And many times, our parents tell us, don't be a kid, don't be a dreamer, get real, go and do this or that. Some of us follow that. We make money, we get degrees, we do this or that, but we see that we are not happy. Some of us decide to follow it, do what our heart says. When I was 17, I knew I'm gonna go and change the world. That was absolutely what belief I had. I knew that when I was 6. I used to get angry when my parents would sit around and gossip and not do anything that would help humanity. I would go and say, how could you just sit around and do nothing socially? There's something you have got to do. When I was 17, I said, I'm going to go to US. I said, why? I said, I'm going to change the world. We don't know anybody. We have never been there. How are you going to get there? I said, don't worry. I know I'm going to go. I followed my heart. Was it easy? Of course not. Did I fail? Gazillion times. Lots and lots of time. But I learned after every failure. And I moved up and did something better and better. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Can you ask a couple of questions?
Sure. Any questions?
I have one for you myself, sure. Which is one of the reasons. I should just mention, Kamran tells a totally different story, and it's always dazzling to me. And so like the talk he did today, I've never heard a single word of this. I was assuming, a lot of times he starts with a bit of his own life story. And some of it is just such an incredible riot and so funny. One of the things that just struck me is, could you just recount your initial departure? What led to your departure and the lunch of your departure from HP, please?
Well,
with the background.
Sure. You know, I was a very aggressive engineer and very ambitious. I was 24 when I started to work at HP and corporate engineering that. And every 6 months, I would go to my boss and say, I need a raise, give me more money, promote me to be manager, I want more engineers, every 6 months. I was on a path like this. People were just saying, how does he get that? Or how could this thing be possible? So in my second year at HP, I went and I convince my boss and his boss and their boss that they should pay my tuition to go to Stanford and learn chip design. At that time, this was 1979, there were less than 1,000 chip designers in the world. It was an art, it was a magic. How do you design a chip that works? Two professors at Stanford had come up with a new way, new methodology, that they said, if you come here, we teach you how to design chips. You can be a system engineer, a software engineer, we teach you how to do this. It was based on methodology of Mead-Conway methodology, Carver Mead and Lynn Conway's methodology. So I talked my boss and his boss and management to pay my tuition. Stanford obviously is very expensive, I could never afford it on my own. And more important, give me half time off, but get full salary, actually with some raise, because I had the initiative to do something more, to go and learn this. And I said, we take HP cameras with me in this thing, and we can record the experience, and then we can go and teach other engineers. We have tens of thousands of software engineers, system engineers. If even 10% of them become chip designers, we would have the biggest capacity in the world to design our own chips at HP and take HP to the next level. Very interesting, convincing thing. They all said, fine, 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 go. So I went a year and a half at Stanford, took all these classes about chip design, designed the chip, it was a communication chip, it got fabricated, came back, and it didn't work. So, failure, right? Horrible. How do you go and explain all this money spent, all this time, you are in total, are you recording this? What the hell? You're a total fuck up, okay? How do you go and describe and say, I'm not so bad, you know? Well, as an entrepreneur, study the rules carefully so you can break them properly. So I went to my boss and I said, I have some good news and I have some bad news. He says, tell me the bad news. He knows me well. I said, the bad news is the chip is not working. So, how do we go and explain this to our management? We paid so much money. Well, he said, no, there's very good news. He says, what? I said, give me another promotion. $500,000 more, a few more engineers. We put an amazing team together. The reason the chip did not work is because I had no tools to get real-time feedback for analysis, simulation, all that. I designed the chip in vacuum, we had no engineering workstation, and we know how to make workstations for CAD-CAM designers. Let us go and design a new engineering workstation with analysis capability, a lot of software for logic simulation, circuit simulation, functional simulation using computer graphics. That was my field. And he says, this is a great idea, but I'm tired of you. Every 6 months, you come and sell me another thing, I'm not going to give it to you. And I said, if you don't give it to me, I'm going to select my best engineer. We are going to walk out and create our own company. And he thought I'm bluffing, because that was part of my study. Every 6 months when I wanted to get a job, I would go and interview in one of the companies where he had a friend. And his friends would come and tell him, oh, how is this Cameron? He comes in here and interviews. So, oh my God, he's here. I'm going to lose him. I better go and give him a raise. So that's how my raises kept coming up. Or he says, I'm not going to fall in for the leap. So I went and I picked up my engineers, the ones I liked. I said, let's go and start the company. Shoo! They are all older than me, but they said, if you say it's good, let's go. How do we get money? I said, come on, with our pedigree, we are smartest people and smartest lab, and you know, VCs would stand up to throw money at us. And they all believed in it. I believed in it. I wasn't bullshit. I really believed in it. Now, reality was a lot different, but anyway. They all followed me, so we went and gave our resignation to leave HP. And my boss's boss was very accomplished. He was my friend and I really liked him, he really liked me. He came and said, you can't leave, come on. and let's go and have lunch. So we went, he took me to a Chinese restaurant. And he started to cite all of these statistics for me. 50% of startups failed within the first year, 90% of them failed within the first 5 years. He said, do you believe I'm a pretty smart guy? I said, yeah, you are very smart. You have lots of people working for you. He says, I tried twice to start a company and I failed. What do you think you have that I didn't have that you think you are going to succeed? So his words are so rational, make so much sense, and I respect him. I was starting to have second doubts. Is this really the right thing for me to do? Maybe I should stay. So at this time, end of lunch, Chinese restaurant, what do they give you? Fortune cookies. So I get that fortune cookie, and I read it. I start laughing, I can't believe it. And I hide it in my pocket, and he says, what did it say? What is it? Why are you laughing? I said, no, nothing is embarrassing. I cannot. He says, I want to see. He said, no, it's very embarrassing. He says, no. So I gave it to him. And he reads it loud. Do not listen to him. So he says, I better shut up. This is just too good to be true. Even if you try to plant it, it's amazing. And go. You're on your own, you got my blessing. If it didn't work out, come back. I said, okay. So that's how I started the company. And 3 years later, HP had interest to buy the company for $50 million. But HP's big competitor at that time was Tektronix. And I had one of my friends at UC Berkeley who was on the board of Tektronix. And he arranged a dinner for us with the executive VP of Tektronix at that time, and he said, I understand that we have competition. What price should we offer you that we would know our competitor would not match? And in reality, maybe if they had offered $55 million, no way HP would match it, because HP was pretty set that they were giving us a very good price. You know, our revenue was $6 million. We were losing a lot of money and had not become profitable yet and whatever. I decided to be aggressive. I said, if you give us $75 million, I know, I guarantee 100% competition will not come. Next day, they gave us $75 million. I said, oh, shit, I should have said $1 billion or something. No, they would not have gone above that. But that's how the story happened. So, fortune cookies have a lot of wisdom. Don't throw them away. Any other questions? Yes?
You mentioned leadership versus management, participation versus distribution. I just want to know, what do you think about Steve Jobs? I don't say he's a leader, but some constitution works.
Since I know him personally to some extent, and I'd rather not to discuss his case per se. From what the public says, there are things that have been written that have not been necessarily following what I have said in here. However, what I give you is the basics of global innovation economy. Not every company excels in every one of these. You look at the way Google is run, you look at the way eBay has been running, you look at the way Intel has been running. Intel even has this thing that they used to promote as constructive confrontation. Don't ever put up with whatever your boss tells you. Stand up and fight. Have a constructive confrontation. So I'm sure within the various different segments, different companies have followed this to different levels. But if you look at what Steve was able to do, he was able to inspire people to the highest level. And he sought a lot of input from people who would come to him and it would inspire them to go and work really hard to do something. He would not come and say, this is what you have got to do, and you know, I have figured it out, this is the way it should be. He would seek solutions, and the people he respected, he actually followed quite a bit. You know, Jonathan Ivey had a huge influence on many of the designs, many of the things. So it wasn't as though he did everything that he wanted without listening to people. If anybody has portrayed that, I don't think that's accurate portrayal.
Do you believe in the singularity, and if so, what's your understanding of it?
I do believe in singularity in not 100% the way that I understand Ray is talking about it. Definitely, you know, Ray is 10 times smarter than me, and he knows 100 times. If you don't know Ray Kurzweil, I highly recommend go and do his reading. He's probably the closest thing we have to a living Einstein. You know, the guy is just unbelievable and knows so much about so many different things. And he is like a huge database of amazing things in all of these things. I mean, I'm a flake compared to what he knows or whatever. But he is also has one of the best brains to go and connect the dots and come up with the thing. So I highly recommend that. So the effect of singularity, the effect of this exponential thing, absolutely, is happening. Many, many of these things are exponential, and the things are coming on. And there is a merging of all of these two words, a single thing that would have different consequences. If I had to say, would it be that our consciousness would be merged with robots, or would it be that we would live longer, and whatever, I would side with the latter case, that we would live longer. And I believe in, you know, the same way as we have iTunes and your iPod, some of your music is local, and some of it you go and get it from the cloud. My belief system, and I'm not saying you should believe in that or whatever, is that there is a non-local source of knowledge out there, and if you learn how to do the matching of impedance, you know, it's kind of like turning the knob on your radio, in the old radios, if any of you still have those radios, that you go on your car radio, you go on 88.5 and you get NPR, KQED. Go to that. Once the frequency is matched, you get the download. There is that element that exists out there so that you could get amazing amount of knowledge from somewhere. And if you, some people try to do that by using drugs, I don't think you need to go that far or do those things. I don't understand the drugs, and I have very little experience. Tried pot, I guess, in college a couple of times and didn't get much of a high. I guess I was too much of a knucklehead or peep or whatever, I don't know what. But definitely I learned self-hypnosis and I learned meditation, and I became good friends with Deepak Chopra and traveled together with him. And met some unusual people, some unusual monks, some unusual gurus, some unusual things. And not all the time, but at times, my, you know, frequency dive matches and I get some knowledge comes that I don't know from where, but that comes. Now, I believe that if the more you start to follow your heart, the more you start to do good things, there is this force of expansion of the universe moving towards things getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And if you align the work you do by following this moral dimension, more things get accelerated, get catalyzed, moving towards that than normally would happen, and more answers will come to you. Mm. And the trick is not get frustrated, because one part of my frustration was when I had that dream about Momentum Computer and went through $40 million and got fired and you know, kicked out of my own company and all of those things. For a year I was suffering and I was really in pain, thinking what's going on and what did I do wrong, and I felt that the universe was giving me some messages and I followed and I got punished. And what is going on there? And it took me a while to understand that that was part of my evolution. Had that not happened, had I not gone through that suffering, because of that, I went and I didn't know what to do with my life. So I traveled for about 12, 13 months, almost continuously, visited many countries, studied many different languages, cultures, and religions. And then all of a sudden the idea came to me that if anybody did as much travel as I did, they would know that we are all the same. The ideas of humanity is all the same. And you know, it's this dogmatic view of either religious dogmatic view of being a very orthodox view in there, or the political view that you either follow a political leader, if you do that, you become a great patriot, and if you don't, you're a traitor. I figured this is nonsense, it doesn't make sense, and we need to use our brains, and we need to look more into this unification of humanity, because the more languages I learned, I saw the roots were all the same. The more religions I studied, very interesting thing I learned. My mom had the wisdom and knowledge when I was a young boy. I asked her once, what's the difference between Islam and Judaism and Christianity? And she said, here, for a metaphor, for a kid, she said something that it was so wise. She said, imagine there is a sun up there that is source of light and source of warmth. And we all enjoy it and have that. Moses comes from one side and gives you a piece of, you know, glass or metal or whatever, and say, go and you know, clean this up and polish it and hold it 5 degrees this way and 3 degrees this way, and you will see the reflection of that light coming and touching you, and you feel good. And Jesus comes from this side and says, no, use my, you know, piece of metal or piece of a mirror or whatever, and polish it and clean it up with my cloth, and hold it 50 degrees this way and 40 degrees that way. And Muhammad comes and says the same thing from this direction. And any one of those, that if you follow the basics of their teaching, you would get the warmth of the sun and the light of the sun coming to you to a degree. What is the problem is people who start to worship that mirror, that piece of glass, and the fact that it should be bent 4 degrees and 6 degrees rather than 22 degrees and 24. And whether you bend 3 times to pray or 5 times to pray, or you eat this thing or you eat that thing, they start to confuse that piece of thing with the power of the. And they start to see that that works for them, they say, this is the only way to reach that. And when you see, listen to Pope Francis, who is one of the first few enlightened popes we have had, he is not condemning anybody who doesn't use his part of that. But when, so you know, he may be on the right side of history. When you listen to ISIS, who says, not only the Jews and the Christians and the Buddhists and the Hindus are all bad, but even within Islam, he says, the Shias and the, you know, Ismailis and the even some of the Sunnis in Iran are all wrong. It's only my special cut of this small sliver of the whole thing is the right way. And that's where you will go to heaven if you fall. And it does not take much to figure out who is on the right side of history, who is on the wrong side. Very simple thing. Think of that long arc of humanity, and it bends towards unification. So any leader who is teaching you something that does not fit with that, maybe is telling you to worship a piece of glass. Or any leader who says, you come and destroy this glass, I will kill you because you are defecating God or Allah or whatever, does not understand much, because by destroying that glass, you can make another glass. The sun is still up there. That's not a very powerful God. If you went and, you know, destroyed Quran, you have destroyed Islam. Not proper way of thinking. Any other questions?
Thank you very much.